Good morning. Welcome to Worship in the Word, Ministry of Benicia Fellowship Church, 935 West 2nd Street, downtown Benicia, California. It's Sunday morning. Let's celebrate. Amen. Lord of all creation, water, earth, and sky, the heavens are your tabernacles. Glory to the Lord on high, God of wonder beyond a galaxy. You are holy, holy. The universe declares your majesty. You are holy, holy, Lord of heaven and earth, Lord of heaven and earth. Now let's reach out to the Lord this morning. Just put everything aside, the cares of the week, no anticipation of the Monday to come. Don't worry about your job, all the chores you have to do. Just let God have his way in you this morning. Amen. Early in the morning, I will celebrate the light. When I stumble in the darkness, I will call your name by night. God of wonder beyond our galaxy, you are holy, holy. The universe declares your majesty. You are holy, holy, Lord of heaven and earth, Lord of heaven and earth. Hallelujah, hallelujah, to the Lord of heaven and earth. Hallelujah, to the Lord of heaven and earth. Hallelujah, to the Lord of heaven and earth. Hallelujah, to the Lord, God of wonder beyond our galaxy. You are holy, holy, precious Lord, reveal your heart to me. You are holy, holy. The universe declares your majesty. You are holy, holy. God of wonder beyond our galaxy. You are holy, holy. The universe declares your majesty. You are holy, holy. God of wonder beyond our galaxy. You are holy, holy. The universe declares your majesty. You are holy, holy, Lord of heaven and earth. It's by God's amazing grace, amen, that we're here together this morning. God bless you. Welcome. It's Sunday morning, worship in the Word. who breaks the power of sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger. The King of glory, the King above all kings, who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. You laid down your life, and I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order, who makes the orphan a son and daughter. The King of glory, the King of glory, who rules nations with truth and justice, shine like the sun in all of his brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. You laid down your life, and I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the Lamb who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. You laid down your life, and I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. You laid down your life, and I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
How's the Lord been to you this week? Has the Lord been good to you? You know, sometimes life is up, sometimes it's down. Circumstances. But in Christ, He sees us through it all. Thank you, Lord.
Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. Down your life, then I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Sing out this morning. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Good morning, good morning, good morning. Let's come before the Lord and just give him thanks for this beautiful day. God, I just want to thank you so much for in a world of chaos, you bring us back into order. You're not confused. You're not at all stymied by what's going on. You are not in a state of preponderance. Lord, you know exactly what's happening. And God, it is amazing to think that we serve a God who knows us all corporately and yet individually. Lord, I pray that you have your way in this little service this morning, that you bless each and every person that comes on board today and throughout the week, anybody that sees this service, that they might be touched by the power of your Holy Spirit and your word. I pray that as I share a message, that it would be encouraging this morning and that I would not get in your way. May you draw us ever closer to you and to each other. These things we pray in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Good morning, everybody. Good morning, good morning. How are you? It's good to see you. I'm going to set my guitar aside here. What a privilege it is to be together today. And I just want to welcome you here. If you haven't been in our services before, the services, I start them at 9:55 on Sunday mornings. They're a celebration service. We have a time of worship. And then we get into God's word. It's very simple. It's just very straight ahead. And this morning, I've got a message for us that I pray is very, very timely. I pray that it brings you right into the heart of God. And that you are, that you see your place in him today. If you've made a profession of faith in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, this is going to make so much sense to you. Because scripture says that the fruit of God's Spirit, the fruit of the Holy Spirit that dwells and lives and operates in and through us is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness, faithfulness, and self-control. Over the past several weeks, we've looked at those individually, all sourcing from love, which is the greatest of these, amen. Love, laying down your own agenda, laying down your life, if you will, for the well-being of someone else. True definition of love. Isn't that what God did for us through his son, Jesus Christ, who died upon a cross for the sin of all mankind? You can't add to it. You can't subtract from it. But I pray this morning that you embrace it. Joy.
joy beyond circumstances, joy which is the strength we have in God. The joy of the Lord is my strength. And then peace, which surpasses all human understanding. Scripture says that Christ Jesus will guard our hearts and our minds in him when we're stayed upon, focused on, moving ever closer towards the embrace of God. So love, joy, peace. Actually, that word peace means that we are moving towards God's peace, that we're moving towards him in a very special way, in a way where that peace which surpasses all understanding leads us into his ever-present and ongoing desire to have a personal relationship with us. Amen? So I pray that today, if you're listening to this or you see it in the future, that you would be drawn close to God. This week might be a little challenging. We're actually going to move into the area of patience. Love, joy, peace, patience. Wow. Are we in a world that is just out of control when it comes to patience? Well, let's take a look this morning and see what the Bible has to say. We obviously won't cover everything, but we're going to look at some characteristics and some aspects of God's patience and how it might teach us and how to develop in, and to grow in our patience and also in our relationship with God and with each other. It's going to be very practical this morning, but you're going to see that it all sources from God and it just absolutely pours out of his foundation of love for people and our love for him and for people as well. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son, that whosoever believes in him shall not perish, but have life eternal. So let's call upon the Lord this morning to be present in our meeting, in our service this morning. Amen to that. So before we dig into this arena of God's patience to see how it would encourage us and enrich us and to empower us, really, I want to bring to your attention a couple of things. A couple of weeks ago, we dedicated our service to Marianne Crandall. What a little angel that walked the face of this earth. A more humble person I've never met. Just the sweetest woman you'd ever want to know. And very unassuming. It's not like she ever ran a big company or made millions of dollars, but I'll tell you what, she was absolutely rich in her love for God, and it just poured out in her love for people. Well, Marianne celebrated her birthday this last week in heaven. So Marianne is in heaven at this time, and we want to remember the family, and we just want to give thanks for being able to know her, to be able to walk with her for many years. And I just have hundreds of stories, and she's just a blessing to me, and I will never, ever forget her and look forward to meeting her again at the fellowship meal in heaven together. Also, I want to just say happy birthday to my wife, Jeannie. And there we go. Happy birthday, sweetheart. Hey, sweet pea, this is your day, your special day, and we're going to celebrate you as well. So each and every one of us are going to have a birthday in heaven one day. We're going to stand before God. And I guess maybe you could say that there might be a birthday celebration. It's our birthing, a crossing over from this life into the life in heaven, the forever life in the presence, the very presence of God. I know beyond the shadow of a doubt, Marianne Crandall heard those words, "Well done, good and faithful servant." So in an effort to encourage all of us and to move us towards that direction, and also being hopeful that each and every one of us will hear those words as well, I want to dig in right now into this area, this arena of God's patience. Okay, can we do that? All right, right on. So good morning. I want to just remind you that the fruit of the Spirit, and not a bunch of fruits in a basket, it's the fruit of the Spirit. So love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness, faithfulness, and self-control. And as we work through these, I pray that you're encouraged in your relationship with God, and that you'd come more and more each time that we meet and be able to practice throughout the week God's calling on your life, and how all of the things that he is doing to shape us and mold us to be more and more like his son, Jesus Christ, is for the purpose of redeeming a lost and dying world. Did you know that's God's purpose? Yeah. For God so loved the world. That's why he sent Jesus to redeem, as a redeemer. All right, so this morning, I just want to drill down into this area of patience. There's so many ways that we could go with this, and I had really contemplated digging into the idea of the technological impatience that is so pervasive in our culture right now. But I'm going to leave that until the end with a little challenge for you, a little mission, if you will. I like to sometimes conclude these messages with a mission possible, all right? So if you choose to take it, great. If not, it'll self-destruct right after this service anyway, so you won't remember it. So if you want to take some notes this morning, this is a good time to get out your Bible, get out your piece of paper or a notepad or a journal and start digging in. So the first thing that I want to share with you is that patience requires the power of the Holy Spirit. So when you are saved, when you come into that relationship with God, where he saves you, he fills you with his Holy Spirit. You actually are filled by the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. And it's the Holy Spirit inside of us that gives us the ability to practice love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness, faithfulness, self-control. It gives us the power to do just that, to grow in our capacity for patience is an empowerment of the Holy Spirit. See, Galatians 5:22, you can write that down. I would memorize that little passage right there because it says that the Holy Spirit is the one that produces the kind of fruit in our lives, love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness, faithfulness, and self-control. And it also says that there's no law against any of these things. In other words, if you are a person who has received the Holy Spirit, who is saved, who is in relationship with you, God has given you the ability by the power of the Holy Spirit to be an overcomer. All right, it isn't a law. It's like there's no law that is against these things. It's why the world can't really understand spiritual things and how spiritual people function. It's that we don't need a law to tell us that we need to be a loving people, a kind people, a peaceful people, a patient people. But it sure seems like we need that these days when there's lawlessness, when there's disobedience, unrest, impatience. It abounds and it's just rippling. It's a ripple effect when people are out of control. They don't know how to be patient. They don't know how to be still. And this whole idea of technology coming in and just, you know how it is. People sit at a table and all they are is they're on these their cell phones, or they're thinking about stuff. They find it hard to communicate. That's an issue that we have to deal with as a people, as a culture. We don't know how to be still. But patience requires the Holy Spirit. All right, if you're going to be patient, you got to trust the Holy Spirit. You got to call on the Holy Spirit. So as we grow in our in the Spirit of God, we learn to actually submit ourselves to the Holy Spirit, and we begin to have the capacity for patience. We become more like Christ. I'll be very honest with you. I inherited my impatience from a long generation of people that were very impatient, even nasty and mean. And it took me a long time to say, wait a minute, that's something that was passed down, that impatience, that thing is wild and it wants to grow and get turned loose in me, and I got to learn how to control it. Maybe that's you. Maybe that isn't you, but I can tell you this, Human nature wants its own way, and human nature will grapple for anything and everything to get its way, and it will express itself in impatience. So the Holy Spirit is the one that produces the patience. As long as we get that point, we can move forward. So patience also requires an attitude of gratitude. Requires that we're thankful for all things, even in the midst of our tough situations, of our trials, our challenges. But we can choose, we can make that choice to be strengthened and encouraged in our lives by the Lord. Or we can choose to be complainers. We can choose to grumble about stuff and, oh man, and wake up in the morning with a sigh. Oh Lord, you know? Wherever we go, we can always find stuff that isn't right, that isn't perfect. We can always find things to complain about. But you can choose by the power of the Holy Spirit not to complain and look for the good and be an encourager by the power of the Holy Spirit. So when you keep this heart of gratitude, this heart of thanksgiving in the midst of long suffering, and by the way, the definition of patience, a biblical definition is long suffering. Okay, looking at things for the long haul, not getting all wrinkled up in the moment, but seeing the bigger picture. And in this case, it's you and I keeping a focus on God, knowing our calling and the direction that we're moving in, trusting Him every step of the way. But we maintain this heart of thanksgiving even in the midst of these long sufferings, these trials, these challenges in our lives. And we see them differently. Let me ask you a question. What challenge are you facing right now? Something that it would be very easy to complain about. Oh, man. Or, oh, this. Or, oh, that. Or how about people? It's easy to, you know, be wrinkled up and blame people for everything. Oh, if it wasn't for so-and-so. Oh, man, if they just hadn't have done that. And we cling to these things. And I'm going to tell you right now, you got to let go of that stuff. You have to let it go. Otherwise, it is going to, it's like rocks in a backpack. If you're on a journey and you're trying to hike somewhere, you don't put a bunch of rocks in your backpack. You lighten the load. See, you let this kind of stuff go and you just let it run right off like water off a duck's back, all right, you are going to be in such a better place and thanksgiving is going to well up in you. Take that thing that you're challenged by right now. Just hold it out and say, there's my thing. There's my challenge. There's my stuff right there. It's just, and then look at it. Is it really that big a deal? Maybe it is. Maybe it's life-threatening. Maybe it's tough. Maybe it's challenging. Maybe it's finances, relationships. Maybe you're tired of being sequestered in place. Maybe you're tired of sheltering. Maybe you're tired of wearing a mask. Maybe you're just tired of stuff. And you just don't know what to do with it. Give it to God in a thankful way, because I'll tell you what, as we unfold this message this morning, you're going to see that it is for a purpose to shape you and mold you more into the likeness of God's Son, Jesus Christ. In other words, obstacles, challenges, even setbacks, even failures can be a step forward. You can fail forward, if you will. You can actually give thanks because God is perfecting a work in you. Listen to this. James chapter 1 verse 4 says, and then as your endurance grows, your long suffering, your endurance, your patience, as it grows even stronger, it will release perfection into every part of your being until there is nothing missing and nothing lacking. James 1 4, God is desirous to work in and through you, that you'd be a long haul person, that you'd be a person of patience. Romans 5, 2 and 4, through whom we have gained access by faith into this grace, all right? All right, Paul is talking about a grace, all right, that we have access to by our faith in Jesus Christ. He says, in which we're standing in this, and we boast in the hope of the glory of God, not only so, but we also glory for our sufferings. See, now this is Paul who suffered greatly, and he's actually encouraging us to be grateful even in our sufferings, because we know, listen to this, you want to write this down, guys, because this is exciting, because we know that suffering produces perseverance. Have you ever thought about that at all? Everybody's looking for the easy life. Everybody's looking for the big clearing, the giant meadow, the place to just hang out and put a hammock up and just rock back and forth, okay? Nothing wrong with that. I like to do that at a beach or somewhere where it's just nice and peaceful. And there's nothing wrong with that. But Paul is saying, look, because we know that our suffering produces perseverance. And check this out. Perseverance actually produces character, and character produces hope. So we got this long suffering. When we're grateful, when we're thankful, when we see the bigger picture, we persevere, and it produces a hope that rises up within us. See, Job didn't lose his faith during the time of suffering, and man, did he ever suffer, right? But God restored him in his long suffering. Oh man, so many times over in the end. You should go back and read Job's suffering and all that he endured. He had friends coming and telling him that he should just die, that he must be the biggest sinner and all this stuff. And Job just persevered and he cried out to God, and God eventually restored him. He didn't lose his faith. His faith actually increased through the suffering. If he says, I know that my Redeemer lives, and at last he will stand upon the earth. Job 19:25. Job had a confidence in the God that had redeemed him. So as we keep this heart of thanksgiving, this attitude of gratitude, we're going to be able to keep our faith and even rejoice when we have to endure and persevere in long suffering. So let's move ahead. So in patience, we see that it comes through a trust in the Lord. That, like that song, trust in the Lord, like Psalm, or like the Proverbs, like so many passages in Scripture, trust in the Lord with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. Love him with everything that you've got. Just trust in the Lord. We see that Isaiah 26 says, you keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on you because he trusts in you. See, so sometimes what God does is he kind of like gives us this little push, right? And he says, okay, we're moving out into some deep water here. You're going to actually get out of your comfort zone. And what do? You say, no, I want to stay here in the port. No, I want to stay under the covers. I want to stay where it's nice and safe. But see, he always does this with our best interest in mind. He actually has our back and he wants us to grow. So through these uncomfortable circumstances and all these situations that might impact our lives, even negatively, God says, look, I can teach you if you trust me. I will strengthen you if you trust me. So patience has a whole bunch to do with learning to trust God through these difficult, uncomfortable circumstances of our lives. So keep your mind on him. Keep your mind and your heart intact and on him, and trust him. So in this situation of trust, when we're trusting God, right? Okay, we know that the Holy Spirit is working in and through us. All right, we see that this attitude of gratitude is shaping and molding us more and more into the likeness of Jesus Christ. We trust God and we learn to trust him more. And it creates an expectancy, almost like an anticipation of something really cool to come about. You know, it's like a kid on a trip. You know, you put your kids in the car and, are we there yet? Are we almost there yet? Hey, Dad, when are we going to be there? You know, you've told them the stories. Hey, when we get to the campground, guys, it's going to be so cool. There's going to be these hay rides out to the beach. We're going to have ice cream socials. You know, you can have the little camping cabin. Or, hey, how about setting up a tent out there? We'll set up the fire in the morning, and we'll cook our bacon and eggs, and it just smells so good. And, man, it's going to be, Dad, are we almost there? See, that's the kind of anticipation. That's the kind of expectancy that God wants us to have when we trust him. It's like, oh man, are we almost there? Are we ever going to get there? No, that's not the attitude that God is looking for. He's looking for the attitude of expectancy, the attitude of anticipation, an excited attitude, because we know that we can trust him. So because our faith is set on what is yet to be seen, we patiently keep on waiting its fulfillment. See, God just works in and through us in just amazing ways, and he wants us to be his kids of excitement, kids of anticipation. And you can ask him, hey, God, are we there yet? Might be a long time, might be a short drive, but it's a daily walk with him. Our best example is found in Christ. Okay, so when we're seeking to be a people of patience, we can look to the Lord. We can see the perfect example of patience as we look at how Jesus treated his disciples. All right, we see Philip, for instance, one of his disciples. And Philip says, God, show us God, show us the Father. And this is what Jesus says. Philip, don't you even know me? We've been together for a long time now. I'm paraphrasing this. But anyone who has seen me has seen the Father. Can you imagine the patience that it took for Jesus just to settle down? I mean, he's teaching these men. He's teaching them the ways of God. He's teaching them. They see what he does. They see the miracles. They see the impact that Jesus is having on the world around him. And yet Philip says, well, hey, Jesus, if you just show us the Father, then we'll kind of understand stuff. And Jesus, he just was so passionate and yet so compassionate. He exercised patience. Philip, you've been with me a while now, and you just still don't understand. But let me tell you, if you see me, you've seen the Father. See, you and I can see this loving example, this loving exercise of patience in the way that Jesus endured the cross for us. He endured the cross, the long suffering, the journey, the road. He didn't go to the left or to the right or fall behind. He went straight on that path to fulfill his mission as Savior of all mankind, Savior of the world. Aren't you so thankful for his patience? Has God been patient with you? You should be nodding your head and going, oh yeah. He has. God has been very patient with me. 1 Timothy 1:16 says, but for that reason, that very reason, I was shown mercy so that in me the worst of sinners, this is Paul, the missionary speaking, this is Paul, all right? This is the man of God who had been training, mentoring this young man, Timothy, and he says, Timothy, but for that very reason, I was shown mercy so that in me, the worst of sinners, so Paul saw himself for who he really was, Christ Jesus might display his immense patience as an example for those who would believe in him and receive eternal life. Paul endured because Jesus had endured, and he recognized that Jesus was doing a remarkable work in him, had redeemed him. The worst of sinners, a man who had actually set out on a journey to destroy Christians and Christianity, converted, became not just a proponent, but an absolute amazing, a missionary, a messenger for God, and discipling a young man to carry on this message. By the way, let me ask you, are you seeing your relationship with God so important, such a priority, that you understand that in whatever place, whatever means God has you, whatever circumstances you're in, God has placed you there for a purpose. With the people around you right now, he has placed you in their midst to be a patient messenger, to be someone who understands that regardless of my circumstances, I'm just passing through. See, that's one thing that Marianne understood. She was just passing through. In fact, I was just talking with the family the other evening, and After I left, I said, is this really true? Did you really say the truth? And I had to go, yeah, I had never, ever heard Marianne say anything derogatory about anyone. Think about that. How many times have you cut somebody down? How many times have you just discounted someone? And think about what that does. Is that not complaining? Is that not shutting down the opportunity for long suffering and patience to do its work in and through you to the influence and perhaps even the very redemption of someone else? Tell me, are you going to remember those who complain, those who rail? Are you going to remember those who endure, who persevere, who bring hope into the arena? I don't even think I have to answer that question. A big part of patience is simply being still and remembering God's loving kindness towards us. Has God been kind towards you? Has he been patient with you? I believe that he has. Psalm 37 says, "Be still before the Lord and wait patiently for him. Don't fret when people succeed in their ways, when they carry out their wicked schemes." See, you have to either trust that God has your back or you don't. This whole idea of fighting and flighting and fight and flight, okay, that response that produces anger. Some people get confused. Anger is actually a good thing. It can actually be your ally. It's a physiological response to something that could be very fearful. And, you know, you exercise patience on a daily basis. You have, and it pays off big time in many ways. Let me tell you a true story. A little over a week ago, Jeannie and I were driving down Highway 1 from the north to the south. Very narrow road, very windy, and we were leaving on a Sunday afternoon. And people were coming the opposite direction. And there was a whole long stream of cars. Very narrow road. It really should have been a one-laner, but it was one lane on either side, but it was exceptionally narrow on this. There must have been 25, 30 cars, pretty much back to back. We're coming south. There's nobody behind us, nobody in front of us, but going north, just a whole stream of cars. And then all of a sudden, I see coming straight at us a Mustang trying to pass these cars with no place to cut in. And it happened so fast that I either had an opportunity to go to the right off the cliff or as over as much as I possibly could and just hope and pray that there would be an opening. And as I look back at it, I really don't know how we survived that. We probably should have had a head-on collision and been in heaven right now. But somehow or other, God just says, "You've been practicing this patience. Be calm, breathe, be still, and just let me." And it's like he took the wheel. And this car came back in miraculously, and I looked in my rearview mirror, and he was just going 100 miles an hour. I thought, "Wow, Lord, what just happened here?" And I didn't hyperventilate or anything. I was like, "You kept us. We trusted you." See, I really want my life to not just be those dramatic situations like that, but the everyday circumstances of life, to be able to trust God so completely that in the stillness of the times that we practice with him, that carries through in our daily lives. Be still before the Lord and wait patiently for him. Don't fret when people succeed in their ways. So there's going to be a lot of stuff that's going to come at you. And in this world, he's talking about something even much greater, the wickedness of that which would undermine your faith, the wickedness of a world that is in direct opposition to the things of God. And we're encouraged to remain patient and be faithful. And as we learn to be still before God, learn to be still, all right? There's lots of things. I wake up anxious many mornings. I go, "Oh, wow. What's going on? Oh, yeah, I'm in the world." But hey, I'm not of it. Let's spend some time, Lord. What's happening? Let's talk. Please, I'm just going to be still before you. I know some people like their disciplines in the morning to like, hey, let's dig right in. We'll read some Bible, read some scripture. We'll have, you know, mobile this, mobile that. We'll take some notes, do a little study. Have you ever just sat down and said, God, I don't want to talk at all. I just want to be still and have you work in and through me. Have you work on my heart. Have you work in my life. See, patience is learning to accept the things that we can't change, all right? As we lay them down before the Lord, we bring it to the cross, we bring it to God. We place our trust in Him as our Heavenly Father, and we can trust that good things are gonna happen. We can trust that regardless of our circumstance, God has our back. Romans 8:28, and we know that for those who love God, all things work together for good for those who are called according to His purpose. And I want you to say this with me this morning. Say, I am called according to His purpose. Don't have any doubt about that. You are called to His purpose. So see, there is actually a dynamic of patience where joy wells up those who wait for Him. The Lord is good to those who wait for Him, to the soul who seeks Him. See, God is good. The time of process that we endure with the Lord is a rich time. It's a time of just marinating in Him. And it's in this place of almost a painful process where God can shape and mold us. It's like he's got his arms around us, and He's hugging us, and He's shaping us, and He's molding us like a lump of clay, forming it into something beautiful. And see, as we discover ourselves more and more in that waiting and that resting, that time of just being still with God, that's where some miraculous transformation takes place. And He also will reveal to us in this dynamic of patience that it's His loving, caring, compassionate example for us that is working on us. See, a lot of people say, oh, God is just so slow. God, why don't you hurry it up? You don't understand God's purpose. See, the Lord is not slack concerning His promise. And His promise is that He is going to see us through. There's no promise that we won't have some difficulties, some trials and challenges, but He's going to see us through. And that's His promise. The Lord isn't slack concerning these promises, as some people count slackness. That God's just waiting around. He doesn't know what's going on. He's old and senile, and that's who He is. Okay, no, no. But He is long-suffering, and He's working in us. He's not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. See, that's God's patience, is working to bring people to repentance. Why doesn't God just do this? Why doesn't God just change that person? Why doesn't God just eliminate that individual? See, that's not the right attitude. The right attitude is recognizing that God's loving example of patience towards us is what He wants to exercise in and through us. What if God, desiring to show His wrath and to make known His power, has endured with much patience vessels of wrath prepared for destruction in order to make known the riches of His glory for vessels of mercy, which He has prepared beforehand for glory. In other words, you and I are vessels of wrath. We don't deserve God's mercy. We don't deserve His grace, but He's withheld His wrath from us mercifully, right? Which we deserve, substituting that which we do not deserve by His grace. See, God gives people opportunity to repent. God gives opportunity to people to turn from their wickedness, to turn from sin and turn to the Lord. Don't you see how wonderfully kind, tolerant, and patient God is with you? Does this mean nothing to you? Can't you see that His kindness is intended to turn you from your sin? See, that's just not something I made up. That's a question right out of Romans 2, Verse 4, look it up. Know this, my beloved brothers, let every person be quick to hear, slow to speak, and slow to anger. Wow, can you imagine what it would be like if the world and its ongoing conversation exercised that truth? Quick to hear. You know the expression, hey, you got two ears, one mouth. Maybe you ought to listen at least twice as much as you speak. You know, sometimes we just talk and talk and talk and we don't listen. That dynamic should first come into play correctly with our relationship with God. Listen to Him. Spend time with Him. Rest in Him. Get to know Him. Be still in Him and let Him do the talking. He's going to ask you some questions. He's going to challenge you because He does not want you to stay the same. He loves you too much to just let you run amok and go your own way. He wants to work in and through you in a powerful way to renew you, to refresh you, so that you would be a person fit for the calling. The worthiness of that calling is found in relationship with Jesus Christ. Be quick to hear, slow to speak, slow to anger. We could really dive down into all of this, and we could really make another complete message series right out of that, because our culture right now is needing people of patience. So I said I was going to have a little challenge for you at the end of this message, and here it is for this week. And I'm going to tie in that technological impatience. You know, you and I are having somewhat of a conversation here, and I encourage you to make some notes, write some comments, say hello to one another. If you have something you want to say to me personally, or a question or a comment, this is a good place to do that. I also want to encourage you to share this message. You can go on your Facebook or wherever, and you can share this message with your friends and family. It's amazing to me that we have thousands of people throughout the week that actually tune in, and I don't know if they watch the whole message or not. I haven't looked at the analytics, but they see what we're doing here. And you know what? We're planting seeds of eternity in the hearts of people. And that's what we're called to do. And you can't do that if you're all wrinkled up about, well, how many clicks did I get? Hey, wait a minute, you know, just let me finish up this video game or whatever. But this whole idea of technological impatience, okay, you're never going to have a relationship with God if you go to bed anxious, if you go to bed and you wake up with this anxiety that's being created by this technological impatience. Conversation has to come into play. People have to be able to talk with one another and share ideas without getting upset and angry. Imagine what it would be like. Imagine what it would be like if every Christian on planet Earth just turned off social media just for a week. Just turned it off. Some of you are already starting to hyperventilate, break out in hives. Your brain is starting to percolate. You know, you're just wondering, you're getting anxious. What could I possibly do if I didn't have my social media? You know what? You might be able to spend time with God. Just marinate, be still, and learn of His patience, and let Him come in and shape and mold you, because that's exactly what He wants to do. He wants to shape you and mold you to be more and more and more to the likeness of His Son, Jesus Christ. Love, joy, peace, patience. Would you join me in a prayer this morning, asking God that He would work in and through us to bring about His patience? Lord, I just want to thank You this morning for being patient with us. You've been patient with me for so long, and I just love You for that, Lord. We want to be transformed by the power of Your love. We want to be shaped and molded by Your hands. We want to be empowered by Your Holy Spirit that we can grow in a greater capacity for the fruit of your spirit, and including patience. We need to learn how to be a patient people, Lord. So we yield to you this morning. Holy Spirit, help us, please. Help us to handle these situations that come our way with grace, with mercy, with compassion, with patience. Lord, we pray that you would help us to remember that patience comes from a loving heart, and that you've been so patient with us. You've been patient with us in the past. You're patient with us right now. And we trust that you'll be patient with us in the future. We've got so much to learn, Lord. You love us and you care for us. Help us grow in our capacity so that we can love patiently and patiently love as well. We want to thank you this morning, Lord, for bringing us together. May you be glorified. May you be lifted up. These things we pray in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. God bless you all. I wish you a great rest of your Sunday afternoon. And I want to also remind you that if you are a covenant member of Benicia Fellowship, next Sunday at 2:00 in the afternoon, 2 p.m., we're going to have our fellowship annual meeting. It's going to be a Zoom meeting. You've got some packets of some part of our agenda and things that we want to do. So we're going to have a worship service next Sunday, 9:55. And then you'll have a break for lunch, and then come back and join our Zoom meeting at 2 p.m. And if you're not a covenant member, but you want to find out more about Benicia Fellowship, this would be a great time just to sit in on that. So if you want a link to the Zoom meeting, just put it in there in the comments, and we'll shoot that out to you as well. Lord bless you. Lord keep you. May his grace and his mercy just rain down on you. May the love of God and the hope of Jesus Christ and the patience of the Holy Spirit be ours forever.